well, now that work day is over, how great is it to be able to now sit down and participate in satsang, making this information, this focus, this emphasis available online to everybody on the planet who has access to internet connection. In theory, it's a great thing. And some are paying attention, some are getting benefit from it, which is a great thing. So, it's a hot day today. Hot afternoon. We have one bird that is singing for us. It's a mockingbird. Just all day long it is. From early morning till dusk it is singing continuously, giving different variations. Pretty amazing. And if my voice gives out, we can just listen to the bird. I don't know if that's coming across. Let's see. Very great. So we're here at Satsang, listening to truth, focusing on truth, making the effort. I feel very useful when I do this. When I'm doing other things, I don't feel so useful. I feel kind of useless. It's like, what am I doing all this other stuff for? It's useless. In fact, it is useless. Satsang is the activity of pointing out not this, not this, not this, not this, that. Just that. I say the vision of oneness, the experiencing, the overlay, Christ consciousness, abiding in the self. It is that. That is the one remedy for all our troubles. Literally, because it overlays all our troubles. So we are saying not this, not this, not this, and then at the same time pointing out what is the remedy. Paradoxically, the more we struggle to untangle the ego dynamics of existence, the more we realize we don't really need to untangle anything. We just need to overlay it. The remedy becomes clearer. The more you untangle and see what existence really is, untangle all the deceptions, see past them, the more you realize all you really have to do is just choose the overlay, choose a new idea. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which enables then this effect arises from that, and one abides in that effect, in the experiencing the feeling of that effect. It's not an emotional feeling or a mental feeling, it's something deeper. We call it a feeling, or an awareness, or a presence. I think that's a better word to use. A presence. There's a felt presence. Not an emotion. Not a reaction. A felt presence. That is the remedy. So, Satsang points out what is not the remedy, and then it becomes easier to see what is the remedy. So what better way to use one's time? There is no better way. And it's great that we're able to do this in the world. We're still able to do this. Practically, it's becoming very difficult in a lot of ways. It's the useful way to use one's time. And the other things that one does, there's a pervading sense that grows, this is useless. Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this if I could be paying attention to satsang, listening to truth? Satsang is just an easy, condensed way to say listening to truth being emphasized and clarified. It's an Indian term. Indians have a lot of terms, very useful, because they've been at this for a long time. right now in the world is not emphasized. What is emphasized is useless use of time. Wasting time is emphasized. Literally, we have a culture that celebrates wasting time. Honest, that is an honest appraisal, an accurate appraisal. So it's really difficult to use time wisely and in the right way, because we are literally completely immersed in a vast celebration of wasting time and effort, squandering. We literally squander our lives, and that is supported from cradle to grave. Everybody supports that. And if somebody speaks up and says, wait a minute, this is a waste of time, they're looked at like, how dare you speak up? Must be crazy to say anything. So this here is saving time, using time wisely to get free of time ultimately. The overlay is free of time. It's not time dependent. That's what being free of time means, not time dependent. In other words, there's no modifications taking place with the overlay. The overlay is not being modified. So what do you need time for? Why do you need to keep track of time? It's exactly the same from in the very beginning. And always, never changes at all. So time is the measurement of change, a modification. Existence is nothing but a vast scenario of modification designed to keep us in a state of deep forgetfulness of what we are. We are spirit, we are truth, we are eternal, we're invulnerable. And we wanted to be prime creator instead of prime created, and that gave rise to this necessity to forget what we are, to go into a state of deep forgetfulness. But the deep forgetfulness does not actually accomplish anything. There's no like end point of forgetting where what is forgotten is no longer is real, ceases to exist, ceases to be real, is negated. So forgetfulness never reaches a point of negating what is forgotten at all. It doesn't even reach a point of diminishing what is forgotten at all. What we are is has not been diminished in the slightest bit by all this dreams of forgetfulness. Never will be in the slightest bit diminished. We simply assume that it has been. That helps us forget. Say, why should we remember something that's been severely diminished? Why should we even remember it? But if you get a glimpse of what you are, just one instant, you see, you know it hasn't been diminished. And then you say, wow, all this forgetfulness is really futile. Doesn't do anything. And it's therefore, if it hasn't been diminished, what we are hasn't been diminished, how can we justify continued forgetfulness on the basis of saying, well, it's justified because it's already been severely diminished, and why would we want to remember something that's been so severely damaged? That is taken off the table. Once you take that off the table, you begin to take a lot of other things off the table too, a lot of other spurious, illogical presumptions and plausibilities. The logic of plausibility begins to be taken off the table. All of this deep forgetfulness is buoyed up by the logic of plausibility, which when you look at it closely enough, you see it's empty. It has no real foundation at all. Kind of keeps hiding this fact that it has no foundation, and it's just merely plausible. Anything's plausible. Doesn't mean that it's true. Plausibility means there's build up a certain kind of case, certain kind of logic that supports itself. And we get tripped up by this. Even though when we examine it carefully, we say, well, it doesn't have anything to do with truth. It's merely a nice construct. Clever construct. And that's what buoys up all of this. So we take that off the table, bit by bit by bit. There's less on the table. It becomes easier to clear the table. So there really is progress that is made in satsang, in self-inquiry, in contemplation, meditation. All there really is progress that is made. It's subtle, but one keeps taking more and more off the table. The ego has less to work with. And then it becomes easier to realize, there's really nothing I need to do at all except choose a new idea, exchange belief systems. Just that one step, nothing else is needed. It's very possible to do that. It's very possible to clarify it, keeping in mind that clarification is not attainment. It's very important to emphasize that only exchanging belief systems, choosing a new idea, only that is attainment. Nothing else is attainment. That's why I say, I have no attainment. None. Zero. It's very important, so people listening, do not get caught up in the notion of some kind of persona, personal attainment. There's no such thing. One who has chosen to abide in the overlay, that's not a personal attainment. That's simply spirit choosing a new idea, and the effect of that idea is automatically there. There's no making it there. No one has found some magical way to give rise to this effect. Nothing like that. So we need to take the personality out of it entirely. Personality will never reach any sort of attainment. No person will ever have any attainment. It's not like that. But it is that spirit gives up the idea that gives rise to the false, plausible notion of a person, of an I, of a persona, of someone who's supposedly giving rise to these effects, to effects. No. It's the idea of wanting to be prime creator that gives rise to all these effects, all of existence. There is no second cause of it. There is no other cause at all. Just that one cause. It brings about this dream of forgetfulness. And everything in the dream of forgetfulness is being caused by spirit's desire to be prime creator, choosing that idea. Everything. So, and spirit chooses a different idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That everything that arises from that is caused by that one idea, and all that arises from that is just one effect, an overlay, an effect of non-negation, not trying to negate anything. Not trying to forget anything. An effect that's not trying to forget itself. Not trying to assert that it's somehow separate from the idea that gave rise to it. It's one with the idea that gave rise to it. It doesn't leave its source. Therefore, it is what it is from the very beginning and always and forever, endlessly. So there's no time. Why speak about time in such a situation? What meaning does it have? It will be exactly the same now as it will be in a trillion years, or 2 seconds, or in the past, or whatever. So, time doesn't then have really any meaning. Time keeps track of modification. Everything in existence is in ceaseless modification, being changed, modified. And this paints a picture of forgetfulness for us. We see this and we say, wow, everything is being modified, so that means that reality too must be being modified. There's no exception. We don't see anything that's an exception to it. So we then assume that what we are is also being modified. The prime creator is being modified. Reality is being modified. And this, of course, then keeps us in deep forgetfulness of what we are, because of what we are cannot be modified Prime Creator cannot be modified. Reality cannot be modified. So it's this very potent scenario that we have been paying attention to. We're aware of all these modifications. And we are like looking at all of them like with interest. Like, wow, this is amazing. You look at people in the world, the kids, and they're looking around and everything goes, wow, look at this. Everything here is being modified. It's incredible. And there are those who fervently love this, or at least say, assert that they love this modification, because why? It gives rise to a belief that one can be Prime Creator. So what one is really loving is the notion of spiritual pride, that spirit can become Prime Creator. In other words, all this is plausible evidence. So what one says they love the world, they mean they love all this plausible evidence that they can be Prime Creator. It's an ego trip, I mean, meaning it's a spiritual pride trip. It's a trip of spiritual pride, that spirit by being aware of all this, can plausibly believe that it's possible that spirit can be Prime Creator. Eventually, somehow. There's always this factor, a feeling of plausibility to it. And that's all there is in this whole scenario of modification. The entire cosmos is nothing but constant modification. Everything is going through cycles of, you know, different types of modification continuously. Doesn't matter whether it's going up or down. Same thing. All modification brings about deep forgetfulness. Doesn't matter if civilizations are being built up or they're being torn down. It's the same. Two sides of one coin. Still modification. And nothing here really stays the same. It's either increasing or decreasing. It's either being constructed or destructed, built up or torn down. Change is constantly occurring. The weather's always changing. Even when we think we've built things that aren't changing, the circumstances that they're part of are changing. Pretty simple stuff, really, to talk about this. Is not difficult. So how can there be any attainment in viewing any of this? It's meaningless. One cannot remember what one is by paying attention to any of this. It's not possible. So where's the attainment in the world? There's no attainment possible in the world. But in choosing the overlay, then that brings deep remembrance, and that is attainment. And, of course, one can do that right here, in the world but not of it, so to speak. The overlay also overlays the afterlife, because in the afterlife, there's also constant modification taking place. We assume, again, as plausible, that somehow after the body dies, then we experience permanence, freedom from modification. So actually that belief is utilized to get us to squander our time here in this world and turn away from satsang, because we say, well, why spend all this time focusing on getting free of modification if that is going to automatically occur after we die? So we can feel comfortable in pursuing everything but satsang while we're alive here, and then once the body dies, we'll automatically be saved from deep forgetfulness and we'll have deep remembrance automatically. Very convenient notion, but I can tell you for certain it's a completely false notion, because in the afterlife there is massive modification going on constantly, very similar to here. There are some differences, subtle differences of various types the various realms. But those various realms, subtle realms, are undergoing constant modification. So the overlay overlays not only our perception here with body perception in this world, but also the other perceptions in the afterlife. Other experiencing the afterlife of all dimensions, all different types of experiencing. It overlays all of that. Everything in the dream. The afterlife is part of this dream of forgetfulness. Just as much as this earth experience is part of a dream of forgetfulness. No difference. No meaningful, actual difference. It's simply, again, part of this vast scenario of forgetfulness. And of course, all this dying, that too feeds the forgetfulness. So does being reborn, feed forgetfulness. The entire situation is nothing but the vast machinery of forgetfulness that keeps us deluded and confused about what we are. Because really, without this vast complexity, we would easily reject any notion that we can be other than what we are. And then we would give up the idea of trying to be prime creator, trying to forget what we are. It was just ridiculous. Because what we are never changes. So how can we forget it? It's still there. So what meaning does forgetfulness have? Really no meaning at all. None. It just enables us to play out this silly whim of being prime creator, to entertain the notion. Entertaining a silly notion is all we get from it. And we sugarcoat that in a million different ways. We try to ennoble this and grandize it, the silly notion of that we can somehow be prime creator. We attach all sorts of spiritualization to it. Makes it seem like we're on the path to something profound. But that's just sugarcoating the silly notion. That's all it is. And no matter what we try, we eventually get weary of it and say, nah, this really didn't do it either. We try to say that existence is marching towards some great objective, some great goal, etc. No, the very most we can get out of it is just this silly notion that maybe we can one day be prime creator, just to have that feeling like maybe it's possible, maybe we can do it. That's it. All we get is a maybe out of existence. And this maybe is continuously flickering out, you know, like a very faint flicker. Barely get this little sense of maybe, and then no, maybe not, then maybe not. We're constantly oscillating between these two feeble feelings, maybe, maybe not, maybe, maybe not. And that's all there is. That's all there is. One day we'll look back and laugh, have a good laugh at how we were able to be attracted to such crumbs. It'd be very funny. We just don't admit that we're living on these crumbs. Because to do so would undermine, you know, our attachment to the idea of being prime creator. And then we feel that we'd be losing something really profound and important. So mainly existence is a desperate attempt to not lose something. What is that? We don't want to lose what we think is an opportunity to be prime creator. We view this all as an opportunity, as something that we can do, that here it is, you know, that the opportunity is here. We have this vast cosmos, and it seems like we should be able to find a way. And so, as soon as we start feeling like we want to give it up and instead choose to not be prime creator, not to try to be prime creator, and then experience perfect peace. As soon as we start feeling that way, we start feeling like we're going to lose something really profound. We get nervous. Lose something really important. We get anxiety, get worried. But the anxiety is not founded on any truth at all. Because there really is no opportunity to be prime creator. So how can we lose it? What we fear we're losing was never there in the first place. So the fear is anxiety is unjustified, has no foundation of fact to it whatsoever. But we imagine it, that, and it afflicts us. As soon as we turn towards truth, there's, oh, something's slipping away that's so important. Don't dare let that slip away. I'm going to lose my opportunity. I'll never be able to be prime creator if I don't, you know, if my defenses don't rush in to protect me. I may let go of it, and that'll be a disaster for me because I'll be left behind. I'll be a failure. I'll be a reject, etc. No, the only failure is to continue to pursue this impossible dream. That's the failure. That's continued failure. Guaranteed futility. So you won't be leaving the ranks of success, you'll be leaving the ranks of failure. How can leaving the ranks of failure be a failure? Cannot. Beautiful afternoon. Yesterday was incredible here in the Bay Area, California. I was out in an extremely beautiful place. But you know, I wasn't happy in the slightest bit. I said, yeah, I've seen it all before. This is just one of these epic May days where everything is crystal clear and the air is perfect and everything is so green and beautiful. And it's just, and I said, yeah, so what? Everything is being constantly modified. You know, temperature will drop, the light will go away, the wind will come up, the fog will come in. Everything I'm seeing is being constantly modified. So it really did not have the kick that it usually has. The reason why so many people live in California is because it can be, have this patina of beauty. People live in various places like Santa Barbara and San Diego on the coast, all over the place in California. And you can go places and you can see, you know, this patina, this veneer of beauty. You have days that seem to be postcard perfect, a lot of them, just like ideal. And so you really have nature worshippers here. Nature worshippers are very attracted to California. I know, because I used to be one. But now I realized I wasn't feeling anything in particular. I realized, well, this is, you know, an absolutely gorgeous day, and it's about as good as it can possibly get, and it's springtime, and everything is just bursting with vigor and you know, growth and everything. But it didn't touch me in any way. I said I've seen it 1,000 times before. Still feeling of futility, feeling of uselessness, feeling of anxiety, all those things are still there. Non-attainment, all of that doesn't touch it. I guarantee you, having spent a lifetime in California, being saturated with, you know, the best that nature can offer, really, best that this world can offer, doesn't get any better if you know you can really seek and find out just an incredible variety of natural beauty in all different ways here. And it didn't touch my misery, didn't help it at all. The inherent misery of existence has no effect on it. None. And I also guarantee you that those who have spent their lives as nature worshippers, in no way are they any closer to true wisdom. They're miserable. They're hoping in vain that somehow they can make this house a home, that somehow they can continue on the idea of trying to seek out all this beauty in nature is that it gives one a feeling like, yeah, I can. It's worth hanging in there and continuing this effort. Because look how beautiful the nice air and trees and taking a nature walk, and it's all great. That keeps one from questioning the situation carefully and saying, wait a minute, you know, I still feel this futility, I feel this anxiety, where's the anxiety coming from, etc., etc. It distracts us, it's very distracting. Very distracting. California is a very distracting place. Extremely so. And being born here, I've had the full experience of it, and I've seen through it, you know. I've realized that's what, you know, people come here for. That's what we're hoping for. You have a beautiful home, beautiful family, beautiful car, beautiful yard, beautiful neighbors. You can go to all these incredible places, the mountains, the oceans, the vineyards, and forests, on and on and on. Wherever you want to go, you can go and just indulge in all of that. The food here is the best in the world, the freshest, no doubt about it. Everything seems to grow so beautifully. And you get that full experience, and then you see that doesn't touch the misery. Didn't touch my anxiety. My anxiety was because I wanted to let go of this effort, a futile effort, and that gives rise to anxiety. Nature didn't calm it because I guess I wanted it so badly that I was not able to be distracted away from it. So the anxiety remained. You see, psychology doesn't understand the roots of anxiety. Does not at all. So they threw up their hands and said, let's just take medicine. You know, just dull it down. The root of anxiety is the inherent desire on the part of spirit to give up this futile quest to be prime creator. And the dynamic is there again that it's afraid it's going to miss out on some opportunity. It's told itself so many lies that this is essential, that we must do it, that what we're forgetting, that we're forgetting because what we're forgetting has been terribly damaged, and therefore we must forget it. And so, of course, the idea of then letting go of this forgetfulness, we feel that we'll experience something that's horribly damaged, something terrible. So we're, you know, very, very frightened and nervous about that. It gives rise to anxiety. Basically, we tell ourselves a lie and believe the lie, and then that makes us afraid to face that lie. Like I said, we automatically insist that our forgetfulness is not just because we want to be prime creator, but that we have to do it because reality's been destroyed, been damaged, some horrible wreck. And therefore, we must forget it, otherwise we're going to be in incredible misery. So any desire to remember what we are gives rise to this horrible dread. And so we look for distractions to keep us from dropping this effort. And so we look for beauty in the world through photographs, you know. Like I grew up on picture books of all types of the most beautiful places in the world. Constantly feeding myself with those pictures, had access to unlimited amount of beautiful imagery of nature and in the world, and continued to pursue all sorts of photography and video and special effects and ways of beautifying everything and all sorts of amazing play of light, etc. And all of that is a distraction. It's an attempt to calm down our desire to exchange belief systems. Because that desire gives rise to anxiety. But what's really necessary is to examine the anxiety, see where it comes from, and to realize it's based on a false premise. So true psychotherapy has to engage in satsang. That satsang is real psychotherapy. And, of course, in this world, the pharmaceutical industry, which has its tentacles everywhere, would prefer that all therapy be looped through, ultimately be directed towards pharmaceuticals. See, there goes my voice because I'm saying something that is frightening to say. But it's true. Psychotherapy has, for the most part, well, it's gone in two directions. One direction is towards satsang, where you have the non-dual, Advaita, A Course in Miracles, all of that. That is genuine therapy. Satsang is genuine therapy. And then the other has gone towards pharmaceuticals. Dull the anxiety. Don't get to the root of it. Just dull it somehow. Bury it. Lessen it. It's kind of saying, well, yeah, we can't really get rid of it, but let's just, you know, live with it and make it less. And of course, we all don't want to suffer from anxiety. It's terrible. Dread is terrible. And really, when you want to remember what you are, everybody will say, no, no, no. And they'll create this sense of fear in you. That's what happened to me. You know, I didn't have any fear of reality before when I was young. Just like, what's the big deal? Everybody said, no, it's crazy, you know. We can't go there. It's devastation. It's awful, horrible. And that gives rise. Eventually, we get this incredible complex of fear towards reality, thinking that we're forgetting it because it's terrible. It's kind of backwards logic, isn't it? We say, yes, we are forgetting, but we wouldn't want to forget it unless it was terrible. Why would we want to forget something that wasn't terrible? So therefore it must be terrible. That's a false premise. But we're really forgetting it. The reason why we're trying to forget reality is because we want to be prime creators. And the reason why we have to forget it so severely is because reality is so perfect and flawless and wonderful that if we don't paint a picture of devastation here in this world, we would certainly, it would not serve to forget reality. Our attraction to reality would be way too strong. Those are the actual facts. The real anxiety should come in desire to experience this world. That's where the anxiety should be. Because here, everything is being modified. Call it what you want. Call it being attacked, modified, pressured, bullied, negated, forced, demanded, tortured, twisted, brutalized. Every word like that refers to this pummeling, this meat grinder of a world where everything is constantly being ground in some way. It's like we're in a pepper mill, you know, and it's constantly turning and it's just grinding the peppercorns constantly. Everything's being ground up. We're in a washing machine. Get out of it, and then we feel anxious, thinking like, uh-oh, this is terrible, but if I get out of it, it's going to be even worse. So we're kind of cut between a rock and a hard place. Sure, we're anxious about existence because it's so horrible, and we know that we're going to be hurt and injured and get sick and everything, and eventually the body will die, and, you know, we're struggling. So we're very anxious, we don't like it. But on the other hand, we think we're doing this all to avoid a worse fate. That reality has somehow been destroyed and we don't dare remember it because it would just be horrible to remember that. So we're caught between the rock and a hard place here. Between, you know, one type of dread and another type of dread. So like I say, existence is dreadful. Literally. No matter which way we turn, there's anxiety and dread. So satsang points out very clearly that the dread of choosing not to be prime creator is ill-founded. There's no foundation to it. That we just invented the notion that a reality has been damaged or destroyed to justify, to hide the fact that we want to be prime creator, which gave rise to this. We're hiding that fact. We don't address it. If we say we're forgetting reality because it's been damaged, then we don't need to look any further. We say, well, that's the reason. And we don't see the real cause, which is our desire to be prime creator. We don't want to see that. Because if we see it, then it becomes very easy to see everything. We say, oh, well, you know, well, of course we have to forget what we are, because if we didn't, we would know that the prime creator already is, and we can't possibly be the prime creator because we were the prime created, and everything is invulnerable there. We'd know it's invulnerable, can never be harmed in any way. So we have to forget that. We'd see that automatically. It's easy to see that. It takes no, you know, sophistication to see that whatsoever. It's like 1 + 1 = 2. You see, on this beautiful day here, even the air is constantly in motion here. The air that was present in front of me a minute ago is probably a mile down the street somewhere else, and it's mixed with all the other air in the area. The air is constantly being mixed. All these bugs are flying around too. You can see them zipping here and there, you know, having to modify their routes constantly as they move around. They're zigging and zagging. The birds are on the lookout to catch the bugs. The bug is flying down the street. It meets the windshield. Instant modification there. All the moisture that was in the bug evaporates. The rest of it hardens up. Then you hit the windshield wiper fluid and it flicks it off the windshield onto the side of the road, maybe, and disintegrates into dust. Everything is eventually ends up as dust. And the modification is ceaseless. Out of negation and dust arises more constructs to be modified. It's a play of modification. It's a play of forgetfulness. Here we are simply noticing it, not trying to stop it. How can you stop it? How can you stop the air from circulating? How can we stop the ocean from having currents? How can we stop all the cycles of nature from taking place? How can we stop the world from spinning? Can we stop night and day? We can live in an underground bunker with lighting, but we're not stopping the spinning of the planet. Can't stop the solar system from spinning and moving through space. Can't stop the galaxy from spinning, moving through space. Can't stop any of the motion of the cosmos. Everything's ceaselessly in motion. Can't stop that. Can't stop the sun from shining. Can't stop the water from evaporating or freezing. Can't stop the bugs from flying around. We try by using pesticides and herbicides and all that to control things. But in the big picture, we cannot control the ceaseless dance of modification. Even the ones who are trying to control it are being modified continuously by age, by all sorts of factors. We literally have to modify food in order to survive. We eat the food is getting modified, being digested. The entire situation is modification. And it's shocking when one listens to satsang like this. What is shocking is not the information given out here, the clarifications. What is shocking is that you realize that most of the world pays no attention to any of this. That's what's shocking. That's important to keep that in mind. Because when you hear these things, you'll say, yeah, of course, it's obvious. And then something will dawn on you and say, you know what? Almost everyone I meet, to them, it's not obvious at all. In fact, they have no idea about it, really. Never enters their mind at all. That's what's shocking. That's what's called forgetfulness. Because if it did enter their mind, they automatically start putting two and two together. And then a lot of other things, clarifications would occur. Can't help but occur. You see, I experienced reality for an instant. And in that instant, I saw that reality is eternal. Can't be harmed. It's invulnerable. Nothing has ever happened to it. And at that point, you know, automatically, I said, oh, wow, wait a minute, you know, these other things, you know, I started automatically clarifying. I just couldn't help it. I said, well, if that's, I know this is true, so this other stuff must not be true. What's going on? You know, why is it, why inquiry automatically begins? So people literally, they have to be steeped in extreme ignorance, extreme forgetfulness, extreme non-attention, extreme overlooking the obvious in order to continue on with this forgetfulness. And they do avoid anxiety. You know, most of the people who are very, very into the world don't seem to experience that much anxiety, not terrible dread. So they seem to be able to function better. People who are into self-inquiry often do not function as well as others because they're saddled with the dread. They feel nervous. I had most incredibly severe anxiety, nonstop. Like I was about to be killed at any moment. That's the way I felt continuously for decade after decade. And I tried all sorts of medications. Nothing worked. Nothing really worked. Finally, it took something that dulled it down enough to so I could function just a little bit. But even that, eventually, I realized, you know what? This isn't curing anything. It's still there. It's not curing anything. It took the edge off it enough so that I could breathe a little bit. So I'm not against pharmaceuticals. Let's make that clear. I'm not saying that anybody should stop them, shouldn't be taking or anything like that. I'm simply putting them in the right context, is that they don't cure anything. Okay? So I did eventually find something that took the extreme severity of dread, made it a little less, so I could at least say, okay, you know, maybe I can survive this, maybe I got a chance. And then at that point I came across A Course in Miracles, and at that point I realized, you know what, this is going to actually bring about a real cure if I get the essence of this and apply it. I know I'm going to get free of this dread. So at that point, I stopped taking medication at all. Stopped. Said, don't need it. It's not. I know this is going to work, so let me put my attention to this. Let me suffer. So then, of course, I experienced the dread again, the terrible dread. But I use that as a motivation to focus in on study and satsang. So most of the people who come to satsang are experiencing dread. I would say probably everyone. There's an underlying nervousness. And you can't just, you know, push through it. You can't just say, well, forget about it, you know. No, it's arising because of this false attribution we have given to existence, saying that it's arising out of necessity. Not true. It's arising out of our desire to be prime creator. So this must be emphasized. It cannot be emphasized enough. It has to be, I have to be a broken record with this, because it's so helpful. Existence is not rising out of necessity. It's rising out of our desire to be prime creator. That's the only reason it's arising. And we are lying to ourselves when we say it's rising out of necessity. And of course, if we say that it's arising out of necessity, then we have to say why. I mean, we have to say, well, because reality was wiped out and we had no choice but to invent a new one, you know, to forget about it and work towards a new creation. We had no choice. It's necessity. That's a lie. 100% lie. Designed to avoid us from recognizing that we are choosing this, choosing to be prime creators, because we're afraid of losing the opportunity to be prime creator. We want to try and make it, even though we cannot make it. That's the truth. So, being a broken record, that's part of my job. Anyone here who wants to help out has to be a broken record. They have to point out that what's most helpful and then point it out again and again. At some point it'll sink in. One day you'll be driving along and suddenly you'll see it and you'll say, wow, I get it, I see it. That you'll see the dynamic. You will literally glimpse it, and it'll last for a little while, and then it will seem to vanish again. But you'll see it, and you'll see the totality of it, beyond the necessity for words. And then as soon as you try to explain it, it becomes obscure again, for the most part. You lose the freshness and the clarity of it. That's bound to happen. But again, as a broken record, I say existence did not rise out of necessity. That is one way to find the crucial key to the entire situation, is to remind oneself of this continuously. That existence did not rise out of necessity. It comes out of our foolish whim of wanting to try and be prime creator. That is the one and only origin of all of this. No other origin. There's zero necessity for any of this. None. Except that effects always arise and are true to the idea. But that's not necessity, that's just reality. I mean, that's the way reality functions. So we can't really call that a necessity. Now, as soon as we choose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, all of this arises. No two ways about it. It has to arise. And again, then we have to deceive ourselves by claiming it's all necessary. But we're overlooking the idea. You know, we're only looking at effects. The idea was not necessary. There was no necessity that we choose the idea of trying to be prime creator. None. And in fact, in the Bible it says how Adam and Eve ate of the fruit of the garden, and they were warned not to do that. So, you know, it's the prime creator warns spirit, saying, look, you have complete freedom to experience all ideas, but there's one idea that you should not entertain, because when you do, you're going to forget what you are, you're going to forget what I am, you'll forget reality, you forget all your riches, you'll forget everything, and you think that you don't have any access to it, you'll believe that it's all been destroyed, etc., etc., you'll fall into a deep, deep sleep of forgetfulness. So spirit is warned, don't entertain this idea. So what does spirit do? It says, wow, that sounds like a really intriguing idea. So spirit jumps at it and grabs it and says, let me try this. Let me taste this fruit. See how it tastes. And of course, then this is what happens. So here we are, you know, sharing this this situation of helpfulness, pointing out and clarifying. Sharing these moments of clarification. Not of attainment, but of clarification. That's why we're here. That's the reason. Not out of necessity, but out of spiritual pride, spiritual adventurousness, spiritual desire to try and be prime creator. That is the only reason that we're here, that we need to clarify at all. Now, of course, in speaking, like I'm speaking, using words, in a, you know, it's linear. There isn't the, you know, the intuitive insight. So it's better, for the most part, to not speak at all. I've had so much insight that I feel I'm able to address all of this and speak about it without really, you know, damaging, causing delay. It actually helps me get used to this. But I've already had the insights. But before, I never spoke at all. I went, you know, maybe 30 years without speaking at all. Hardly at all. I mean, I never said anything. Nobody would have any idea that I'm interested in any of this. I simply notice the insights. You can see them. They quickly, like there's a quick clarification, suddenly you realize, ah, I see it. This is the way it is. Real subtle and quick. And it's best to just remain quiet. Don't try to amplify it. Don't try to share it. Don't try to do anything. Just check in with how you feel and realize that, you know, everything is still the same, still here. I have this big bee flying around right now. So in satsang, it's silent. Usually people are not conversing. That's why. Because it's important to have an atmosphere where everyone feels empowered to have clarification take place intuitively, and that no pressure on them to say anything. It's very important. As soon as one reverts to words, the clarity vanishes for the most part. It's an extreme type of preparation that's necessary to speak about it at all. So I've been through like an incredible amount of preparation to be able to even talk about this. Because generally, it really, in most instances, words only cause obscuration to take place. So satsang, silent means there's no social conversation going on. There's no discussions taking place. There's no reverting to words. Sure, that there can be some back and forth if there's a question or this and that. But it's a minimal thing. It's better to just sit quietly, not feeling any pressure to talk at all, which is a great situation, really. It's the ultimate situation in this world, is to feel no pressure to say anything. Or do anything. Again, it's satsang. Not only is it silent satsang, but it's like a do-nothing satsang. You're not required to do anything. You're not required to sing a song. You're not required to do a dance. You're just sitting there like you're inert. You're not required to do anything at all or say anything at all, which is the most rare situation in this world. It's something that people, you know, really theoretically would give anything to have that opportunity, to feel empowered in that way, that here you're not required, there's no expectation for you to say anything or do anything. All that's required is attention. That's it. But you don't have to be moving your body. You don't have to be in some asana, some meditation pose. You don't have to be forcing anything. There's just kind of a relaxed awareness and attention and a receptivity to what's being said, and allowing clarification to flash through your mind, for it to be there intuitively, suddenly, you know, it'll you suddenly be aware, like, wow, it's very clear. And then don't have to do anything about it, don't have to say anything about it. Don't have to write down notes about it. See, taking notes is really doing something. It's really saying something. It's using words. It should be, satsang should be note-free also. No note-taking. Because people will say, well, I need to remember this. No. What is important is to recognize that the insight took place. It cannot be remembered. As soon as one tries to remember it, it's gone. It's just like if one experiences the overlay and then tries to remember it, it's gone. The overlay overlays everything. It's seamless. What can be remembered? The notion of remembering puts it into time in the first place, meaning that it was remembering a moment in time. But the overlay is not a moment in time. It overlays all time. And as we said earlier, since it doesn't change at all, time is a useless way to look at it. So remembrance is useless. Can't remember clarifications. You have to experience them. And ultimately, we're going towards the experience of the overlay. And it's not something that can be remembered or grasped through words. You can only, one abides in it, one just simply experiences it. No need to remember it, because it will be exactly the same the next moment, and the next, and the next, and the next. So why, what need is there to remember it? That's the trouble. That's really a trouble. Because we automatically assume, there's a chain of assumption that we're caught up in. If we believe all of this rose necessity, we believe that reality somehow has drastically changed. Otherwise, why would we try and forget it? And therefore, we assume that nothing remains the same. And therefore, when we experience the overlay, we'll automatically assume that it's going to be changed. And therefore, we immediately say, wow, well, I better remember what it is. I better somehow put it into words, put it into some format, some symbology. While it's fresh, while my memory is fresh, I better get to work on that instead of just continuing to experience it. Because we will automatically assume, well, it cannot possibly remain the same, because reality didn't remain the same. And if this comes from reality, we know that reality changes and modified, so this will be modified too. So it was this wonderful, wonderful moment. I know it's not going to get any better than this, so I might as well now go to work trying to compose a poem about it, or a song or something, make a painting or something. And then, of course, we're not experiencing it anymore. So that is this terrible chain of assumptions when we refuse to admit that all of this arises from our desire to be prime creator. You see? When we refuse to see that and admit it, we'll automatically then pull away from any experiencing of the overlay of peace, assuming that it cannot remain that way. And the wise thing to do is try to symbolize it in some format that seems more permanent to us. We'll take notes on it. Put the day, okay, on this day, this moment, this hour, I had this experience, and I was in this place, and I was in these clothes, and then we'll write a book about it and tell people about it, etc., etc. So keep them, try to remember what it was like, etc. All of that mitigates, completely, obviously. Because if we're still experiencing it, we'll say, wait a minute, I'm not working on trying to remember it. So we may have we can experience the overlay for an instant, and then immediately the ego kicks in. And if we try to experience it for 2 moments, the ego jumps up and says, "What are you doing? You're going to lose the opportunity to remember it. Because if you get so used to experiencing it, the ego says you will not have a remembrance of it, and suddenly it'll change, and you won't have any remembrance of it. You're not prepared properly, and so we feel guilty and say, 'Oh boy, I better not miss my opportunity to remember it.' better go to work on writing a book about it. Those who abide in the overlay generally don't write much, don't say much, etc., etc. Great examples of that are Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maima, two great realizers, two of those who simply were perfectly aware of the overlay, of the true nature of reality, that it's invulnerable and eternal. At all times, they were perfectly aware of this. So they didn't, you know, write books or compose music and poetry and try to do all these things to, you know, encode it, so to speak. Ananda Maima could not even read or write. Had no, zero interest in any of that. Didn't need to. She was directly experiencing truth constantly. Why would she need to read or write? What good would reading a book do for her? None. Served no, zero purpose. Same with writing. Why should she need to write anything? She was literally directly experiencing the flawless, seamless overlay and the direct experience of truth and reality and the prime creator at all moments. There's no reason to write anything, knowing that it will always, it's unchangeable. If we know it's unchangeable, why would we need to write a book about it? There's no need. I guess Ramana gave out some teachings that other people maybe wrote down. But you could tell there's no interest, no necessity for that. Sure, realizers can do things, but you realize it's not out of necessity. Other people may request these things enough, and they finally say, you know, say, oh, okay, you know, just to kind of quiet you down, and we'll do this. And, but, you know, you can tell they're not acting out of a feeling of necessity at all. People wanted to build all sorts of temples and ashrams for Ananda Maima. She said, no, there's no reason for that. There's enough temples and places of worship already, more than enough. You need to start utilizing them instead of building more. And they kept insisting. They said, Ma, we need to build a hospital, you know. So there's a charitable hospital, Ma. Ananda Maima, Ma Ananda Mai Charitable Hospital in Benares, Varanasi, Kashi, near her ashram there. And, you know, lots of charitable work goes on there. But she said, no, there's no reason to do that. I have no desire and necessity to do that whatsoever. But they kept insisting. We need to build a school. You know, we need to build ashrams. We need to do this. And she said, well, you know, whatever. I don't feel any, you know, need for that to take place at all. None. But if you insist on it, and, you know, I'm not going to try and prevent you from doing it, because I feel no need to prevent you either. But I'm just saying that your time would be better served, you know, by paying more attention to the satsang rather than trying to collect funds to build a hospital. Which is true. As far as your spiritual, you know, awakening it goes, the highest, best use of your time is satsang. It's the best. Contemplation. You can have satsang with a book designed specifically for that. Some books are designed for that, like A Course in Miracles. It's a self-study, self-study satsang. Designed specifically to encourage inquiry. So occasionally, there can be tools like that made. But the one that does it has to be from the grace of God, and seeing that this would be useful. But when one is here in the world, satsang is extremely useful. There isn't any real necessity for books at that point. Books can still be utilized, but there's no necessity. It's very important to realize that ultimately the goal is to get free of books. Ultimately, okay? Books are helpful when one is very, very caught up in superficiality and believing that words are important. But ultimately, higher culture uses spiritual teachers, satsang. That's a higher culture than books. one goes to a situation where there's no obligation to do anything or say anything or write anything down or remember anything. That's a higher, much higher culture. So we have degenerated as a culture, as a world, severely into what's called education, reading, writing, remembering, speaking, all of this. And Satsang has become an orphan, for the most part. And what happened was in India, where it was still valued, that the Westerners saw that and said, wow, we really have lost this, or losing it severely in the West. Let's, you know, bring some of that over into the West. Now, of course, we've had our own traditions in the West of attending churches and synagogues and the like that. And but there again, in a church, one remains silent. There's no obligation to speak or do much of anything. Listen to what is being said and take in what is being said. There is some of that present. That's gotten watered down. That should be a form of satsang. And it has been throughout the ages. It's important to make it more obvious, more direct. It's important to spell it out. No need to say anything, no need to do anything, no need to write anything, no need to remember anything. Just pay attention. Put your attention there. That's what needs to happen. Pay attention, which means don't let your mind wander. Don't be thinking about what you're going to do. Don't be, when you have an insight, don't be thinking about the book you're going to write about it. You're not going to write any book about it. Anyone who does is wasting their time. Wasting your time. Unless for some reason someone who's truly awakened sees perfectly clearly that a book will be helpful. But it's often not so. It kind of reinforces the notion that one's supposed to write a book. That's a very great delay tactic. It's the idea you need to write something. No, you don't. Again, only the overlay, the vision of oneness, is attainment. And there's nothing that needs to be said or written necessarily about that at all. There's nothing, no application of time can truly reveal it. It cannot be revealed. Okay, it can only be experienced. There's no means of revealing it. Because all means of revealing it are overlaid. So it can't be stand revealed by a book or a song or a poem or a ritual or a dance. Singing. No, there is no means at all that can reveal it. It's a choice. It can be experienced, but not revealed. So the emphasis has to be off of writing books, has to be off of reading books, has to be taken off of saying anything or doing anything. And the idea of satsang is that there is someone who has been particularly geared properly to say something. But the rest, those who come to it, have to have the feeling that they're not obligated to say anything. Otherwise, there's no real satsang taking place. Very important. Very important. So let's emphasize this, that no matter how smart one is, how advanced one is, etc., if one goes to satsang with the belief that they need to say something, then that's not real satsang for them. They have to let go and say, you know what, I'm under no obligation whatsoever to ask a question, to respond verbally to anything, to engage in anything whatsoever. I'm free of that burden. Only then is there a feeling like, yeah, I'm in real satsang. It's a different feeling. It's like a wow. You can feel it. So this is really very important information we're getting into right now. You have to seek for that situation where you feel you don't, there's no obligation to say anything or do anything, write anything down, respond in any way. That burden is taken off of you. It's a great burden taken off of you. Teacher should convey that. Somehow the teacher, the satsang, the one who is hosting it, let's say, conveys that to you. And then you relax, and then the burden's gone, and then suddenly you feel available to actually pay attention instead of searching through your thoughts as to what to say. Because you realize, you know, you may not say anything at all, and that doesn't matter. Because whoever's hosting it knows the truth, knows how to clarify it, knows how to speak about it, will bring up what's important, will be right on topic, and will give plenty of food for consideration, for intuitive insight to take place. And you don't have to do anything for that to take place. And it's already understood that there is no need for any response, because any response only dulls it. Now, of course, in satsang, there can be some interaction that, if it just happens naturally, without any feeling of obligation, that can take place. But if one doesn't want to, there should be no feeling that one's supposed to do that at all. That's expected, not expected of anyone. No necessity. I mean, I don't, for instance, right now I'm speaking, I don't feel any necessity to answer any questions or interact in any way. Because I'm positive that what's being said is highly relevant already. It's digging very deep already. And it's easy to touch upon the complete depth at every moment. We're not any, there's no distance away from that. Truth cannot be modified by lies. You know, that's an ultimate statement. It's easy to make ultimate statements that bring us right to the situation. I say, of course, there's no necessity, zero necessity for existence to arise. It arises from our desire to be prime creator. That says it all right there. Every statement is enough for complete clarification to intuitively arise. So there's no reason for someone to say, well, did you mean to say this or mean to say that? No, there's no reason for that. No reason for that whatsoever. That's just a delaying tactic. And so it should be very clear there's no necessity for someone to say, well, maybe you meant to say this, or can you please clarify that more, etc. No, the clarity is there already. What needs to take place is the receptivity to the clarity, is to allow the intuitive seeing to take place. That the seeing is clearer. It's a crisp, clean, fresh, clear seeing that's different than the seeing of that you're used to of the world, which is cloudy. But intuition has this, like, oh, it's just like 100% clear. You say, ah, wow, how can I be any more than 100%? And then you will ask, why did it disappear? And then we have addressed that here, you see. Because we assume that it must change. Just because we believe that reality has changed. Therefore, everything, I mean, that believe that existence is reality, and everything here changes. So out of all of that, we immediately assume that 100% clarity must change into something less than 100% clarity, or more or less, whatever. Some modification must take place. But no, truth, what can modify truth? What can be more true than true than truth. What truth is less true than truth? You know, truth is always 100%. It's not more, it's not less. It doesn't change. It's not modified. So when we see truth, and then we jump back from it, we're assuming modification and trying to sidestep that, but it's not a necessary step. So eventually we get more and more comfortable with not jumping so quickly, you know, not reacting so quickly. We're getting closer to finally deciding to abide in the overlay rather than catch a glimpse of it and then jump back. That's the trouble we all have. We have exactly the same trouble, everybody. Everybody will get glimpses of truth, glimpses of clarity, etc., and we all, you know, recoil from it. And gradually we become less reactive, less recoil. We still step back from it, like sort of a knee-jerk reaction. Still there, remains. It's very difficult to get past that, but we must. We get less and less of a knee-jerk reaction, less severe. We may sort of move aside a little bit, but it's slow and it's not, you know, panicky, reactive. Then we realize, oh, okay, I moved away from it. Why? Because I believe existence arose out of necessity, and therefore I believe reality was modified, and therefore everything is modified. Therefore, I don't want to get trapped in believing this wonderful experience, that clarity I have, is not modifiable, because I know that can't be true, and therefore I'll be believing in a lie, and eventually it'll cause me to suffer. See, that's the chain of illogic. It's the chain of logic based on a false premise. See, logic is consistent with itself, but when it's based on a false premise, then it's insanity. And yet the logic does have consistency within the premise that it's operating under, that it's supporting. So in other words, if, you know, reality was modified, then from that standpoint, logic can have a consistency. So insanity has a consistency. It just has a false premise. And there's no buts to truth. It's like, truth is true, okay, but. In other words, okay, but what happens when it gets modified? There is no modification. But we'll say, well, wait a minute, I lost sight of it. So that means it got modified. No, we assumed that it would get modified, so we preemptively jump back from it to try and adapt to the modification that we are trying to figure out. What's it going to modify as? I want to make sure I stay aligned with it. So I know it's going to modify, so let me work on figuring out, you know, where I can meet up with it again in its modified condition. That's literally what we're doing. So we preemptively jump back from it and not realize, and we blame it and say, well, it modified, it shifted on me. No, it didn't. Truth doesn't shift. We take a preemptive step and assume that we're doing so to meet up, to align with its presumed modification, and think that they were being proactive. Again, logically consistent with the premise. So we're not attacking logic, the consistency of it at all. We're simply saying the premise is false. And that's why everybody can relax. We're not dealing with the consistency of logic, but rather making sure that we have the right premise, and pointing out that the belief that reality can be modified as a false premise arising from the desire to be prime creator on the part of spirit, which is what we are. So if you imagine anything, imagine that you come across a satsang where you suddenly feel that you have no, you feel no obligation, you don't have to say anything. You can be there, full attention, and there's no demand on you to say anything or do anything or be anything. You don't have to stand up and say, I'm such and such, and I'm done, this is my resume. There's no request for any resume, any information about your life. You don't need to provide anything, you don't need to say anything. Don't need to contribute anything as far as substance goes. Imagine that you come across that. Don't need to provide any answers. And then imagine that. And then that feeling that comes from that is, feel that, and you'll feel that's different. Whole different level of presence, of presentness, of being present, being available. Because you no longer have to filter your availability through words and concepts and all of that, and actions. Imagine that you could see perfect peace and not feel you need to describe it to anyone. Not even need to raise your hand and say, hey, I got it. Not need to even talk about it, report it. No need to report anything. You don't need to go to Satsang, and the next day you come back and say, I have a report I need to make. No, you don't have to make any report. Or you have, you know, a string of insights, and then you don't need to go back to your hotel room or wherever and write them all down. Don't need to write any books. No reporting, no book writing, no notes, you'll be able to remember. You come to Satsang the next day and you, no one will ask you, you know, so did you make some progress? What did you get yesterday? And remember that, and you know, you don't have to say any of that. Like a blank slate. All that pressure is relieved. No pressure. Then you'll find your listening is an entirely different level. You're actually hearing. You can afford to hear. Because what happens if you really hear and you get all this incredible amount of clarity and you think you have to write a book about it? You'll be overwhelmed. You'll say, my God, how in the world can I possibly put all this into a book? It'll kill me. It's so difficult. I mean, it's just unbelievably stressful. I'll never be able to do it properly. And then you start completely stressing out and thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to get some help, and you know, what kind of, you know, images can I put to it, and what kind of music, and before you know it, you are in a state of extreme agitation, and then you'll be terrified of insight, and you'll say, I don't want to have that much insight again because it causes me this anguish. How can I possibly, you know, present it, symbolize it? And boom, that stops you just like that, stopped in your tracks. So the notion that those who are awakened have to write something down, etc., is not true, because truth is inherently within us. The voice of reason is within us already. This is from the very beginning when we chose this idea of trying to be prime creator. The voice of reason was placed in us to remind us of the remedy. Everyone has it within them. Everyone that wants to remember will find a way, will go in that direction. And again, everyone, reality is still exactly the same as it's always been. And we can glimpse that at any moment. And as soon as we glimpse that, then automatically self-inquiry begins for us, automatically. And we'll automatically progress more and more and more clarification So whether someone writes a book or not is not the what's important. What's important is that the pressure be taken off. The expectations that we need to somehow symbolize it, write a book about it. That's impossible pressure. Because how can you write a book about the overlay? You can only say what it's not. It's not, you know. Use statements you can make, you know. It's been done, the little, you know, verses, etc. That's done, but a book? No. What a waste of time. Seamless. You know, how can you assemble fragments to reveal what is seamless? It's a waste of time. Just experience the seamlessness. If one feels that the experiencing of seamlessness is only for the purpose of motivating them to assemble fragments to try and approximate it, then one will be absolutely overburdened by the experience of seamlessness. No symphony is great enough. I used to be a musician, writing music, and so when I would get glimpses of clarity, I would feel obligated to compose something that approximated this, you know, gave some kind of emotional approximation of what I experienced. But this was a dreadful burden, the worst burden imaginable, because some of the clarifications, experiences I had were so, you know, clear and rich that it's not possible to compose anything that can approximate it. Because it was all real. It was all present moment. It was all revealed right now. And the quality was eternal to it. In a composition, you have linear, you know, things are being gradually revealed. But truth is not revealed, it's experienced. So peeling, musical composition peels back layers and, you know, has layers, and then you reveal the layers. It's like packaging. It's really saying, what kind of packaging can I put on it that will somehow reveal the inner content of it? And nothing does. No amount of packaging can do that. So it becomes an obsession. It becomes an intolerable burden if one feels that they have to devise a packaging that is sufficiently wonderful to give an indication of what's really inside of the package, you know. How can anything set in time be sufficient to reveal the timeless? What is timeless? Cannot. It's nothing but a fumbling, bumbling attempt. But if one feels that that's what one's supposed to do, the burden becomes horrible. Because of the burden of failure, insufficient, incapable of doing it. And the feeling of failure, so it's horrible. If one feels one needs to, like, paint a picture that captures it, you know, perfectly, it's a horrible burden. Really. It's presented to us as if it's some great honor. You know, like, you're so gifted, you're so blessed to have this some artistic capability, some capability to make an exquisite packaging of it, you know, and that you're supposed to, out of necessity, you need to do this as a service to humanity. That's an insane burden. It's the ego that's saying that. Because ego wants us to stop at the packaging and say, well, this is sufficient. This is good enough. Don't need to look within. That's what happens in beautiful packaging. The ego say, well, why do you even need to look within? This packaging says it all. Says most of it. Says enough. And we say, yeah, okay, we'll stop here. Because again, the premise of the ego is working on is that reality's been destroyed, negated, wiped out, damaged severely. And that all of this forgetfulness is out of necessity. So it recognizes our desire to experience truth. And it tries to divert us from that by just putting this beautiful packaging over it and saying, look, the packaging is sufficient. So all these artists are being told to package it. The real purpose is to try and do such an exquisite job that the ego can say, ah, that's enough, right? And you'll say, yeah, that's beautiful. The song is wonderful. I don't need to look any deeper. That's good enough. So you have these, you know, musicians, you know, spending their lives trying to come up with this wonderful, beautiful music. And artists painting their whole lives trying to paint something wonderful and beautiful. And it's a horrible burden. Artists have tortured lives because they can't do it. It's insufficient, and the ego berates them and says, "You got to do a better job because the desire to look within is still there. You haven't nullified that." And the artist says, "I got to come up with something better so that somehow the people feel satisfied with it." And people on net will never be satisfied with art, never. They still want to look within because they know they're missing something. All art is missing something. What are we missing? We're missing the experiencing of what we are. And the desire to experience that never goes away, no matter how long we're in forgetfulness of it. And so, all art is insufficient, leaves us feeling still that we're missing something. And of course, the artist is tearing their hair out, saying, "How come I cannot do something that is so great that people won't feel that they're missing something?" Always that's the way, no matter how much an artist is praised. The artist knows that the one who's doing the praising, deep down, they have a accusation to make, and that is, you know what, this is insufficient. Your art is insufficient. I feel like I'm missing something. I'm lacking something. And the artist will, you know, feel depressed, terrible. And of course, the artist wants to hear from sycophants who say, "Oh, when I look at your art, I feel like I'm missing nothing." You know, that's music to the artist's ears. It's also a lie. And deep down, the artist knows it's a lie. They're being lied to by sycophants who know how to flatter the artist so they can get some more eye candy, you know, so they don't look within. It's sort of a codependency situation. And artists know what the game is, you know, and they feel for other artists, they really do. They realize that the torment and torture that fellow artists are in. And they know the game, the sycophant game of the camp followers who, you know, will say, "Oh, you're so wonderful, you're so wonderful, you're doing such a great job," etc., etc. See, now in satsang, we do away with that. Real satsang. Nobody's coming to praise the host of satsang. Nobody needs to say anything. It's all understood. The one that is hosting satsang is doing so because they're capable of doing so. But there's no attainment in any of the words. Realizing they're only experiencing the at-one-ment, the vision of oneness, the overlay, that's the only attainment there is. And so there's no reason to talk about any attainment other than that. And there's no reason to pretend that the words that the host is using is sufficient. That you're not missing something. No reason to say, "Oh, I'm missing nothing. I don't feel I'm missing anything." It's all what you're saying. It's all there. Not true. Not true at all. So there's no reason to be a sycophant in satsang. There's no reason at all. You can drop that entirely. No pressure. No codependency that way. There's no picture that can be painted that leaves one not feeling that they're missing something. It's impossible. Until one experiences the overlay, the feeling that we're missing something will be there. Guaranteed. I don't care who it is that's hosting the satsang. Doesn't matter. You could have a satsang with Ananda Maima and Ramana Maharshi, you could have satsang with Ramana Maharshi too, and if you're not experiencing the overlay, you will feel something is missing. And it's useless to say, "Ramana, can you say a little more?" You know, as if saying a little more will remove that feeling of missing something. No, That feeling's always going to be there, so just to recognize it, acknowledge it, and say the only way that feeling vanishes is when you actually choose to abide, experience the overlay continuously, and not recoil from it with the assumption that you need to align with a modification of it. Again, the game of saying, oh, Guru, you're so great. I feel no lack of anything. I don't have any feeling that I'm missing something at all. That's just flattery from someone who's nervous about experiencing the overlay. They say, I hope I don't have to do that. I hope I can find something that's sufficient so I don't feel I'm missing out on anything without having to do that. That's the game. That's all it is. That's all that it is. Nothing more than that. And that game continuously goes on. You know, flatter the guru, flatter the host of satsang, tell them that they're just everything, and you, in their presence you feel no lack of anything. Not true. So it's a waste of time to even go there. And there's no reason to excoriate the teacher, the guru, the host of satsang by feeling, well, I still feel, there's something lacking. Of course. You say, I still feel I'm missing something. Of course. No matter what anyone says, you will always feel that way until you choose to experience the overlay, the vision of oneness. You will always feel something's missing. What is missing? The experiencing of what you are. The remembrance, the perfect remembrance of what you are. That's what's missing. That's what's lacking. And no teacher can fill that lack. Only your own deep remembrance, which comes from actually experiencing the overlay, the peace beyond understanding, the seamless, gentle peace that overlays all other effects, the one effect that is not touched by any other effects, the timeless effect that never changes. That which is free of modification, that which is not being modified, only that gives the perfect reminder of what we are, and then we have no feeling of we're missing something. So it's great to focus in on this, For me, this is satsang. The arrangements in satsang are simply practical, not intended to say that, imagine some sort of attainment that's not there, or pretend that one has got it without really getting it, or try to inflate something that, that a picture is being painted, a perfect picture is being painted. No. No such expectations. But clarification, again, it certainly can happen, will happen, and familiarity will happen. That is very important. Familiarity is really the key. That will happen automatically. Automatically. And the more one feels no pressure to do anything about it, the easier it is for familiarity to take place. One can just feel, yeah, I'm in familiar territory. I'm getting used to it. I'm getting used to this type of clarity. Yes, and one day one will feel, oh, I'm very used to this. Not a problem. I didn't have to write a book about it to get used to it. Now, people use all sorts of different techniques to kind of tune in, which is okay. But there shouldn't be any false expectation. If one wants to write, one can write. If one wants to compose music, they can do that. If one wants to talk, they can do that. But there, it has to be seen that that's not it. know, you're still going to be feeling you're missing something. But it can be used to tune in. For instance, by producing these videos, I tune in to clarity. In order to share it, I have to have it. So I have to dig deep. Really focus and be attentive and pass on, pass along, share the clarity that arises. So it's helpful for me, it's helpful for others. It's a win-win. But I know that whatever I'm passing along is not it. Never will be it. These teachings, this satsang, will never be it. Will never be that. Only the vision of oneness, the overlay, the experiencing of it is that. It's that remembrance. It's the perfect remembrance, the flawless remembrance. And the remembrance has to be perfect and flawless and timeless in order to, so that we remember what we really are. We're not just remembering anything, we're remembering what we are, what God created. Yes. So, it's very specific, has to be exact remedy. Has to be flawless remedy, a remedy that cannot be modified. Cannot suffer any modification. That has to be the remedy. So, this has been very helpful. Let's see if my voice can still hold up. My feeling is it's been very helpful sharing this. Very profound. It has cast a certain perspective on the situation. Very panoramic and very clear. And again, I'm not going to go in and transcribe it, take notes on it, do anything in particular except, you know, find a way to post it online. I'm not going to celebrate, not going to tell people, hey, you know, I really got some great insight, etc., etc. Not going to compose a song about it, not going to write down the date that, you know, I did this on this and this date, and that was great, you know, and nothing. Just what I'll do is go in and get dinner, cook dinner for people, and then I'll watch a baseball game, Giants-Dodgers game. That's probably what I'll do. And then after that, I'll work on getting it up on YouTube. Something like that. Or maybe not watch the game. I don't know. But, you know, it's nothing out of the ordinary. Not much. I feel like we've dipped into deeper water. No question about it here. Every video I feel that way, but in some more than others. But always there's that feeling that we've gone a little further, or much further. Taken a big step. Or several large steps towards really establishing the right culture, the right context for satsang, for listening to truth, which is all important. One can do it by oneself. It's better if there's a culture of empowerment and encouragement. Which happens simply by satsang taking place and many people going to it and availing themselves of the opportunity. That's how it happens. Transmission is by osmosis. It's sort of a felt presence, like it's happening. This is taking place. And it's passed along. There doesn't need to be a lot of chatter about it. You know, some will take place. It will be, you know, passed along and people will find out about it. And the more of it there is, the more sense that, you know, hey, this is the right way to spend time. This is what I should be doing. In other words, I come home from work, take a shower, and then, you know, go to satsang. Spend a couple hours there. That really is the right culture, the right civilization, the right use of time. Sure, we need to work in this world, right? When we come home, there should be several hours at least available for focus on satsang. That should be the culture. There should be no pressure to use those precious hours in some other way. And in the present culture, there's this incredible pressure to squander one's time. And there again in the morning, there should be time. One should not have to rush off for work at early in the morning. The workday should start at a time which enables us to spend several hours in the morning focusing on truth, satsang. And there again, the end of the day should also provide us with several hours. The workday should not be so long. I would say like a 6-hour workday is probably better. And it should be more like 4 days a week. The 2-day weekend doesn't provide enough time to go in depth. There should be time on the weekends to really go in depth. I would say a 4-day work week, 6 hours a day is about right. Now, of course, this will quote-unquote slow down the engines of progress or manufacturing things. And we'd say, what would that do? Would that impoverish us as a civilization? Not at all. We have way too many things. We spend almost all our time getting things and then getting rid of things. If we took all the time that we spend just getting rid of junk and garbage and stuff and put that on the satsang, what an incredible situation it would be for us. I know firsthand how much time is spent literally getting stuff and getting rid of stuff. Everyone's lives are cluttered with stuff, and it's so difficult to get rid of it all constantly in this process, which is just chewing up our time, wasting our time. Simple life with a few necessities and maybe a luxury or two is fine. Just keep it basic. What's important is the time that you spend, the time you should have time in the morning and time after work and time on the weekends where you really can give your all, really focus. That's essential. And this world culture really does not support that. It's not going in that direction. Everybody is so intrigued with productivity, with efficiency, of using more and more of your time for productivity, of working faster, more intensely, producing more, getting up earlier, taking stimulants. What do people do? They get up in the morning, slug down their coffee, and off to work they go, you know, battling the commute. Their mind's already geared up, racing about the day. How can I be more productive? How can I push others? If one's in management, they're thinking, how can I get more productivity out of everyone? And if it's a worker, how can I satisfy the demands and increase my productivity? How can I rise in my career and make more money? It's a rat race. And those who are, you know, cheerleaders for the rat race are not doing anyone any favors. They're basing their efforts on a false premise that existence is arising out of necessity. False premise. So we either have a society based on a false premise or on a true premise. One or the other. When we try to mix the two, neither one is really happy. Societies that are based on the premise that there is a remedy for existence, and that existence did not rise out of necessity but out of a whim on the part of spirit, those societies, cultures, civilizations will make time, make certain that there's time, and one does not have to work 52 weeks in the year. There will be vacations, there will be blocks of time, like a month off, you know, that kind of thing. But I can tell you, where I live, Silicon Valley, it's an absolute rat race. Everybody's on stimulants. You know, they're pushing themselves. whether it's a cup of coffee in the morning, one in the lunch, one in the afternoon, one in the evening, to keep going, to keep working late. You know, antidepressants, anti-anxiety medications, blood pressure, high blood pressure, cholesterol medications, all sorts of medications that come about because we're pushing ourselves brutally to make more and more money, get more and more status, all this stuff, package ourselves better. So we can say, hey, I don't need to, you know, remember what I am. I'm not missing anything. Give that impression that, hey, we're not missing anything. Look at our lifestyle. We're doing everything. Got it all. We're trying to, convince ourselves that we've got it all. We don't need to, we're not missing anything. Don't need to look within. Don't need to discover the truth. Don't need to remember what we are. We're trying to convince ourselves we're not missing anything. And of course, it's a lie. We live in a society, everybody's lying to each other constantly. That's my feeling. As I go about, I say everyone is giving this impression that they're not missing anything, which is a total lie. And the honest person is very, very rare. Do you come across that now? Someone will say, you know what? I know I'm really missing something. I don't think I can, fulfill that, to get rid of that feeling by my life here. It's not working. I know it's just not going to work. What do I do? That's wisdom right there. Usually it happens when the elder people realize at some point, no matter what I do, I still feel I'm missing something, and now I'm too tired to do it all. It's all, my life's been a sham. It's been a waste of time. There are those who realize that later in life, it's having wasted my time. That's a positive step. It's time to step into satsang, but it's also a tragedy that a culture would push this wastage of time on everyone. Because what we really need to do is start out from the get-go with time to attend satsang from the get-go. And everything is geared that way. Not towards increasing efficiency of production, but increasing attention to clarification. And that takes time, just like productivity takes time. We're going to use the days of our lives in some way. So it's either going to be this or that. We're either going to emphasize that we can't do it all. We cannot give the impression of having it all and at the same time spend an appropriate amount of time on satsang. Now, where I live, one has to keep up appearances. One cannot stick out like a sore thumb and say, I'm not really trying to look like I have it all. So I have to pretend at least a little bit that I seem to have it all. But it's not really possible to actually have that. Can't take vacations, for instance, and haven't pursued money so that I can do anything like that. Don't have the vehicles, a lot of stuff that's just doesn't quite say enough, that I have it all. No. By having it all, people say, well, I got a great bank account, I've got retirement set up, I've got my house, got my mortgage paid off, I've got, I'm able to buy presents for people, I'm able to throw parties, I'm able to take vacations to all these places. I'm able to, keep my health going, be part of a gym. I'm able to afford the medications, a nice health plan, on and on and on and on and on and on, like that. I can't say any of that stuff. But at the same time, I have to keep up appearances like everything's great, and support their notions about having it all, not missing anything. Sort of like when in Rome, do as Romans do. But what's important is to spearhead this clarification. Use the time this way. So right now I'm just sitting here. See, I'm not gardening, not cleaning up, not doing accounting, not counting money, not trying to network, not trying to advance a career, not taking a vacation, not shopping, nothing, just sitting here. That's it. sitting in a very nice place, which is good. It's fine. But I'm not, you know, doing it, not moving around, not going anywhere, not meeting people. All around me is constant action, really. I live in a place of doers, you know, very active people, constantly on the move. Not standing still for a moment. They're like the bugs that I'm looking at right now. These bugs are zipping around. I don't see the bugs, you know, taking a moment to reflect. They're ceaselessly in motion here. The late afternoon sun, as it dips toward the horizon, is backlighting all these bugs. And they're all milling about, zipping around. All different types. All different speeds. Humans have the capacity to be still. I don't think many animals, you know, anything else really has that capacity. We can, you know, delay some animals, like the cat over there is just, you know, hanging out all day, just sleeping. That's a different thing. We are not sleeping here in Satsang. We are focusing our attention in the most profound way and remaining available to do that. We're deferring maybe eating, sleeping, making money, moving about. We're deferring all these various things, actions, to sit quietly and listen, pay attention. We're deferring all of that, and we have the capability to do that. Whereas those bugs there, they don't. They're ceaselessly in motion. It's a compulsion. They're driven by the complete compulsion to buzz about. Occasionally, some animals will break the mold. I had that happen. This bird, this blue jay, would just come visit me and just sit there and just look at me for a long time, not doing anything, not making any noise or any movement. I say, "What's going on with you? It's completely abnormal for an animal to act like that." Distance, all the action of cars, motorcycles, birds are flying all over the place, breeze is moving around. People are bustling to get ready for the evening. Gotta get something to eat. Go to, you know, soccer practice, come back from that, have to prepare for tomorrow's, you know, blistering pace of work, have to answer all these emails and all these texts and update, you know, their Facebook page and make sure they catch their favorite shows on television or watch a movie. Chat to, you know, a million different things, hobbies, etc., 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 but I wonder how many are actually focused on Satsang. They're basically focused on maintaining forgetfulness, deep forgetfulness, out of fear. As we have seen, there is a dread of not doing this. And it's felt like an incredible taboo, like we're going to be destroyed if we don't do this. course, we've made that up. That's a tactic. We've made that up. We're believing our own advertising. We accepted a false premise so that all this could be entertained, and then we believe that this false premise is true. And we say, oh, I didn't have anything to do with that. It must be God. Prime Creator must have put that there. Not true. We put it there. We put the false premise there so that all of this would seem to be, you know, necessary. And as long as we think and believe it's necessary, we will not inquire into it. The great thing about catching a glimpse of reality for a moment is that once we know the nature of reality and see it, experience it, we will then feel that it is justified to inquire into existence. We will feel absolutely entitled to inquire into it and say it's the right thing to do. But if we do not have a glimpse of reality, we will feel that it's a stupid thing to do. It's a waste of time to inquire into existence. There's no need to. It's useless. Why do we even want to do that? We just take it as a given and then say, how can we exploit things? How can we get rid of this feeling of missing something? How can we have it all? That will be our goal. You know, the famous saying that Wall Street saying greed is good. What they're really saying is our goal should be to have it all, to get rid of that feeling of missing something, and everybody should pursue that. That's the mantra of the modern age. Have it all. You too can have it all if you just find a way to, if you pursue that every instant of your life, you too can have it all. That's the mantra of delusion. You cannot get rid of the feeling of missing something. We're missing something. What are we missing? We're missing the experience of ourselves, what we are. We miss reality, we miss truth, we miss the infinite richness of our experiencing in reality by choosing ideas, the endless tapestry of riches. We miss that. We miss the stability, the invulnerability, everything. We miss everything about reality. We really, really severely miss it. And what can possibly compensate for that so that we don't feel that here? Nothing. Are you kidding? You could own Pebble Beach and golf course and play there every day. You'd still be tormented by this gnawing feeling of you're missing something. You say, well, maybe I should be go to Augusta and be playing the Masters too. So maybe we'll get on a jet, we'll play Pebble Beach in the morning, we'll go to Augusta, play the Masters in the afternoon, then we'll fly, you know, somewhere else and think we have it all, we're not missing anything, and that evening we'll be there, we'll having the finest food, wining and dining in the best restaurants, and we're still feeling missing something, and then we'll have the best companionship and friends and paramours and whatever, and the relationships of all types, and we'll think we got it all, and now we still feel, wow, we're really, really missing something. We have all the houses, have 5 different houses all over the world, fly from one to the other, we have yachts. Yeah, does still feel, you know, tormented, like, I still don't have it all. Somebody else has more, they must have it all. So we pursue greater and greater wealth, influence, control, strategies to get more, to take from the wealthy, take what the wealthy has and get it for ourselves. All these strategies are attempt to have it all. We'll take drugs, parties, adventures, everything, trying to get rid of that feeling of what we want to have it all. Never, never get there. We want to go faster. That's one of the big ones right now. Go faster. Have more speed. Speed of computation. You know, they advertise new phones. Yeah, it's, 20 seconds faster. Already got the information. I got it all. Already got the tweet. Got the tweet 10 seconds ago. And you're still waiting for it. I got it all. You don't have it all. That's advertising plays on that entirely. That's the root of advertising. Is hinting at, you know what? If you have this, you have it all. Or you're going to get rid of that feeling of missing something if you just buy this, if you just do this, just take this trip, take this cruise. You'll have it all. This will get rid of that nagging feeling. That's the whole basis for advertising. Of course, it's all a sham. It's all a sham. In advanced cultures and civilizations, you'll find out there's no advertising like that. Because everybody knows that's a sham. When cultures decay, advertising rises, becomes king. Marketing and advertising becomes king and queen. And when cultures rise up in wisdom, giving time for satsang, advertising drops away. It's a sham. People realize it's nonsense. They have no interest in it. No one's interested in marketing and PR and facades and packaging and all that stuff. They're interested in attending satsang, hearing truth, being reminded of truth, clarification. Here comes the cat. I guess the cat is getting hungry. See, the cat can sleep all day, but when the hunger hits it, it cannot maintain its sleep. It's compelled to get up. But here in satsang, even though we feel hunger, we can defer that and say, no, wait a minute, let's override that. This is more important. Let's stay with it. It's like that, but the cat cannot do that. The cat will say, the most important thing in the world right now is getting fed. That's it. Nothing is greater than that. But we, as humans, can say, no, there's something greater. I'm tired. I'm hungry. But this is so important that I can continue to pay attention to it. I have the capacity to do that. So we're blessed in that way, greatly blessed. We must not squander this blessing. Have to keep the knife of clarification sharp. So don't let it get dull. It very quickly gets dull in this world. Very quickly. Scary. Because of the dynamics that have been pointed out in this video and others. Everybody, they'll say, well, yeah, we know about truth, but we know it's going to be modified, so what we're doing is we're working real hard to meet up with truth around the bend, So we're engaged, we're fully engaged, and maybe you're not. That's nonsense. That's the engagement of folly. Truth is right here now. Exactly the way it always is. There is no around the bendness to it. There is no preparing to meet its modification. And yet the world is so overwhelmingly full of self-deceit and all these rationalizations for existence. Excuse me. So there's an example. Right there. There is an example. You see? Again, here's another, something I had forgotten to convey. Is that we feel a necessity to stay in shape. Get exercise. Exercise like a god to us. Because we feel the more fit we are, the more we'll be able to, things we'll be able to do. The more we'll be able to pursue having it all. And the more we'll be able to get rid of this feeling of missing something. In satsang, of course, we're not exercising. We're sitting quietly. Maybe we're a little bit overweight. Maybe our cardio is not great. But the knife of clarity is being sharpened. It's cutting through all the deception. And ultimately, That is what is important. It's not how fit we are. You know, we may not be able to take a hike, go on a bike ride, do all, you know, go surfing, to go to the gym, play basketball, you know, go on a trip, do this and that because we're not so fit. That's okay. A little bit is fine, but if we, you know, if we take an hour to exercise, that's an hour that we didn't give to satsang. This culture is obsessed with fitness, you know, and the flip side of that is obsessed with non-fitness. It's kind of the flip side. People are so obsessed with distracting themselves from satsang that they either do it through obsessive fitness or being a couch potato and playing video games and eating junk food, you know. So I'm healthy enough. I'm fit enough. Can't do anything extraordinary. I can walk about. But the effort to avoid satsang takes different forms. People will say, oh, you know, I will. I'm just not fit enough yet. You know, I've got, once I'm super fit, then I feel I'll be able to be successful at it. Or one might say, you know, I'm not able to sit quiet yet. I need to become, you know, 300 pounds. So fat and out of shape that I can't even move. And then maybe I'll be able to attend satsang. I won't be able to actually physically move. So, yeah, which is, again, foolish. Because the purpose of sitting quietly is to give one's full attention that one can move. It's not that one is unable to. It's that one is choosing to not engage in activity, but rather use attention, focus one's attention. That activity distracts from that. So these are excuses, you know, morbid obesity and being super out of shape or being, you know, obsessed with being in shape. Those are excuses to avoid satsang. One is just to be moderate. When one is not trying to make excuses, one is automatically moderate. One automatically adopts the middle path of moderation. Automatically. And not, you know, emphasizing anything but the satsang. That's the emphasis, and everything else is just takes its place in moderation. So there's no real reason to teach moderation. It automatically takes its place as soon as satsang is made primary. Everything else automatically adapts to that and takes its place. So we don't need to put the cart in front of the horse and try to teach all sorts of, make some sort of restrictions and regulations and some kind of spiritual bureaucracy. It's not necessary. All that's necessary is to spend time in satsang, and one's life will automatically take on a moderate means that will facilitate satsang automatically, without paying much attention to it. It just becomes moderate just from lack of attention. You're not really interested in any extremes. Shopping, doing things, whatever. You do what has to be done to keep a minimum, you know, keep up appearances and get by, etc. But you always manage to find a way to spend time. You know, for instance, not here. I've pushed dinner back. I've pushed watching a baseball game back. That's okay. I know in a while I'll go in and get some dinner and watch some of the game maybe. Yeah, that's okay. So everything bends to and adapts to the schedule of satsang, of spending time in this way. And we don't have to, you know, build temples and build places, etc. There's plenty of buildings already in the world, plenty of places. With the internet, we can do it online. You can just sit in your room or on your mobile device if you want to. Anytime. Don't have to carve out a big carbon footprint to go anywhere. You see now that all the cats, a bunch of cats here, three of them, they're all playing. There again, in satsang, we're not playing. We're not playing games, sports, diversions of any type. We're not doing crossword puzzles. We're not frolicking around. We're just sitting. In whatever way is comfortable. It doesn't have to be some sort of special posture. Just whatever is comfortable. Don't have to be frozen statue. But everything in moderation, because the interest in truth is such that it moderates everything else. Everything else sort of is on the back burner. It's kind of like on low flame. It's like when you're cooking and you put something on low flame, you know you don't have to worry about it too much. It'll stay warm. It's not going to condense and boil away. It'll take a long time before it does that. It just kind of stays warm. So your life can just stay warm. You know, everything in your life doesn't have to be hot. It stays warm. It's what you put on high flame is the satsang. The time that you spend, the attention that you give, that's on high flame. That's boiling. That's what your attention is on. The rest of the stuff, you look at the stove and say, oh, I got all these other things, you know, the lid's on, they're on low flame, don't have to worry about them, they'll be there. I'm looking here at a bird of paradise plant. It's in full bloom. And I'm reminded of the church, the altar, last Sunday had this bouquet of birds of paradise and anthuriums and ferns, and it was the most gorgeous bouquet I've ever seen. You know, it was really an eye-stopper. Talk about eye candy. But you know, all of those blooms will fade. The water will get real stinky. Everything will be thrown out. It's beautiful, but it doesn't, you know, what's more important? Would I rather be looking at that bouquet or sharing these clarifications? I'd rather be sharing clarifications. That's vastly more compelling because we literally can sense, get a sense of freedom from misery. We realize, yes, there truly is a way, and I will not have to keep suffering from substitutes for what I am. And literally, once again, fully know what I am. And that will be tremendous. So it's more compelling. No matter how beautiful anything is in this world, satsang is more compelling. Guaranteed. I've seen a lot of beautiful flowers in my life, that's for sure. But this is more compelling, way more compelling. If I had a choice, you know, to go to like Antelope Poppy Preserve or give a really top-notch satsang, it would be the top-notch satsang. It's deeper, reaches way, way deeper than even the most extraordinarily beautiful display. For instance, I was at Antelope Poppy Preserve in 1 year. I'm not sure what year it was. Maybe 2003. And it was, you know, 100-year bloom. And it was incredible. People were going out of their minds, you know, just jumping around. And I couldn't even drive because I was too busy looking. You know, I had to stop the vehicle and get out. Say, I can't drive because I'm going to run into somebody because I'm not paying any attention to the road. And, you know, I've been also was in Death Valley when they had their 100-year bloom, where there were wildflowers everywhere. It was incredible. The starkness and the juxtaposition of starkness, uncoloredness, no life anywhere, and then all the flowers, wildflowers everywhere. You know, was an amazing juxtaposition. But then again, people were just kind of like wandering around in a daze. It was so amazing. But then comparing that then with a satsang is better. I don't think it's possible to get a much of a higher nature experience than that Antelope Poppy Preserve that day. People were there from all over the world. I have pictures and video of it, which I've shared from time to time online. And the air was like honey, because all the poppies were in bloom. There are billions of poppies in bloom, really. And the whole atmosphere was like nectar. And everybody was like intoxicated, wandering around, just going, wow, what's going on? Here comes somebody up the pathway. Okay, let me put this on hold. Okay, every interruption is very instructive if one sees it, you know, in that way. That was a neighbor giving us the brochure and obituary of their loved one had passed away. Has passed away recently. Someone I've known for a long, long time. And, you know, even dying is not as good as satsang. They were sick for a long time. Even the release from all that misery is not as good as satsang. It's important to know that, to realize that. It's not as profound. I guarantee you, everyone believes that dying is profound. It's not. I think the biggest surprise of all when people pass away is the realization that it's not profound. We'll say, is that all it is? We assume that it's profound. And we can experience that assumption, but we will still feel that there's something lacking. And whatever experience we have, it doesn't last. You know, people talk about near-death experiences, NDEs, and the experiences they have, some of them seem to be profound, but of course it doesn't last. In satsang, we're talking about what lasts. We're talking about the overlay. We're talking about being reminded of what's eternal. So we even don't have time for dying. It's not important. It's not profound. We don't need to expend our time preparing to die. I know a lot of people, as they near the end of their this particular incarnation, they spend a great deal of focus and effort on preparing for that transition and trying to make it completely profound instead of continuing to pay attention to satsang, which is actually the right way to use one's time. Because after one passes away, one realizes, you know, it's not really profound, and one's in the afterlife, and there's all these modifications going on, then one needs to get right back into satsang at that in the afterlife, which there is. There's satsang in the afterlife, too. I remember that Sri Yukteswar, the guru of Paramahansa, Yogananda, said that he's a teacher in the afterlife. There's a guru there, holds satsang. Somehow he communicated that. I guess he appeared to Yogananda after he had passed on and said, this is what I'm doing, you know, this is what's going on. So there is satsang in the afterlife too. So when one passes on, one needs to right away get into that satsang there. The best way to do that is to continue to do it here. And if one is engaged in distractions here, when one passes on, they will continue on with distractions in the afterlife too. Whatever one's habit is here, that will continues on in the afterlife. So, you know, there's no profundity to that. Very important, because everybody is moving in that direction here, towards passing on to the afterlife. And the ego uses that as a great distraction. The ego will say, well, you know, satsang's great, but you're about, you know, you're moving towards your transition. It's coming. And that's more important. You need to focus on that. It's not true. That's a tough one. Those who can continue satsang even though they're sick and they're moving towards their transition, those are the ones who really get it. Because they know that dying doesn't free them from anything. Simply that now they're in the afterlife and they're continuing their patterns there. And so they realize, you know, well, I may not get it here. I may not choose the overlay before my transition into the afterlife. But as soon as I transition into the afterlife right away, I'm going to continue satsang. Because I can get it in the afterlife too. It is entirely possible to choose the overlay in the afterlife. Entirely possible. Just as it is entirely possible to do it here. I'd say... I don't know about percentages or really. But both places, one either does it here or in the afterlife, one or the other, that's it. So, by maintaining one's focus on satsang, even as one is moving towards transitioning into the afterlife, one then it's greatly benefited, saves time, saves a massive amount of delay. One just in the afterlife, one, you know, attends the satsang that's available there, continues on with it. You know, they have a subtle body there, not a gross physical body, it's subtler. And so that just continues on. So it's very important. Very, very important. In a culture of distraction that we have now, what happens when people transition to the afterlife? Well, they just continue on with all their diversions. All the silliness, all the distractions, all the preoccupations and compulsions, all the wastage of time. And then they find themselves back here, transitioning back into another incarnation where they continue those patterns. Squandering time, wasting time. Still believing in a false premise, in the logic that arises from a false premise. Still refusing to challenge the premise, to look at the premise. And then therefore they're simply wasting time. Literally, if people are not attending satsang of some type, they're wasting their time. Whether it can be self-study with satsang, with inner truth, if one is not attending in some form, one is wasting one's time. Plain and simple. Squandering it. I mean, not they don't lose all of it, they don't squander all of it, because the suffering, the misery that's building up from wasting time is accumulating. So the bank of frustration and resentment is growing, the bank account of that is growing. Getting more and more frustration, that's growing. So their future suffering is increasing, which will eventually cause them to decide not to squander any more time. So time is not entirely squandered, and now the cat is biting me because it wants to be fed, you see. So in satsang, don't bite the host when you say, I'm hungry, I'm tired, I want to quit, etc. Nah, just say, okay, but that's not that important. It's not that important. But at some point, we do need to feed the cat, I would say. And the cat is saying, right now is the time. He's sort of upping the pressure. He's very talented at that. Gives a little pressure, then increases a little more, a little more, a little more. Eventually he'll get around to, you know, snagging my clothes, which is the ultimate step he knows that will work. But he never uses that first. He always saves that for the last. Very well-mannered cat. It's only if you don't respond earlier that he eventually will try to snag your clothes, which he knows you jump up if you do that. Right? Yeah. So, I guess this is enough for now. Very great. And we will continue this on and continue to use our time wisely. Very great. That's it.